US Bangalore, and before that he was the director of research, and for a long time he was head of the Department of Agricultural Extension at US Bangalore. And Dr. Neelam Khetrapal, who is another emeritus professor from Palanpur, Hisar. So these are the two reporters of this technical session too. Without much taking much of your time, I request the chairman to conduct the session. Thank you very much. And the distinguished speakers in this session are Dr. B.G. Mukhopadhyaya, who was former Chief General Manager of NABARD. Dr. Mukhopadhyaya, I just would like to briefly introduce Dr. Mukhopadhyaya. Dr. Mukhopadhyaya is my classmate at IRI, and he was my predecessor, president of postgraduate school students union at IRI, PGSSU. Next year I became the president, and he retired as the chief general manager of NABARD. In fact, when there was a campus recruitment for development officers of NABARD, when we were doing a PhD, third year PhD, we went for an interview, and they selected 100 officers all over the country, including IARI, IIM Ahmedabad, and the Indian Institute of Science. So out of 100 officers, Dr. Mukhopadhyaya topped the list. He was number one. I was number two. I followed him. Because he was my predecessor president, I followed him as a president. Again in NABARD, he was number one, I was number two. He was posted to Calcutta, I was posted to Mumbai. He continued in NABARD, I discontinued in NABARD. So I resigned because I didn't like the nature of job. I quit and joined the university as associate professor. And he is a trainer and farmers, bankers and government officials. And he is a voracious reader. If you go to his house, you will only see books. Because his wife complained to me several times that on the day when he gets the salary, he will draw all the salary, go to book house and purchase the book. And she was crying, this fellow doesn't bring anything home. Why can't you tell your friend that at least spare some time for running the house? So that was the state of affairs. And anyway, it is hardly fine to... to sleep even on his cot. You will just see books and books. And he can speak extempore on any aspect, because sometimes if I have to go somewhere for giving a talk on some difficult task center, if I am asked to speak, then I will ring up and tell him, this is the topic I am going to speak in next day, and send me some material. He will instantly write something and send it by mail. So that is the dependency which I have on Dr. Mukhopadhyaya. And he has done his master's in OD at Bowling Green State University of Ohio. And he has visited, maybe after this program, he is going to, which country, Malaysia? Rome. He is going to Rome. He is on the move most of the time. He is an international figure. He attends several, he is invited in several countries for many conferences and all. You can see he got an international award also just two years back. And he worked as a faculty at the Bankers Institute of Rural Development, which is located in Lucknow. So I can speak any length of time on Dr. Mukhopadhyaya, but time is the constraint. So with this brief introduction, probably I invite Dr. Mukhopadhyaya to speak. And my special request to Dr. Mukhopadhyaya is restrict to timings of less than 20 minutes. This is the only request. Otherwise, you will go on speaking for 2-3 hours. Please, because you have to care for others' time also, please restrict your times. Thank you very much. Dr. Mrinalini, to welcome the dignitaries on the dais, chairman, co-chairman, and the reporters of the...
this conclave, and must like to compliment ICR in general and Education Division in particular for improving the process of knowledge generation and skill. It is really a sight to see the Team Education Division working. One after another, Dr. the three ADGs and under the leadership of Dr. Rathore has really transformed. I have been watching Education Division for the last 20-25 years. But, one of the ADG said that you don't see four together. Today, these days, we see all the four together. That has made an impact. Now, coming to this session on knowledge and skill requirement for the agricultural graduates. I have two questions, and I would like that we all address these two questions. Number one is, are all our graduates equipped with the right knowledge and skill? I think there has been a lot of change that we have seen, witnessed. But are the graduates, are agriculture graduates who are producing, are they equipped with the knowledge, required knowledge and the required skill? And number two is, agriculture serves three times a day, or maybe four times a day, breakfast, lunch, tea and dinner. But farmer's son doesn't want to be a farmer. Why? The glamour which we see in management, in medical, in other sciences, why not in agriculture, which feeds us. And believe me, if we don't have enough food grain, we can't eat, you know, IT and gold and silver and all that. So food is so important for us. Now, I would like you to also think further. Let us compare our ICAR with ISRO. ISRO, when cryogenic engine was, the technology was not being given to us last 30-40 years back, they developed indigenous technology. And today, the satellites from various other countries come to India and then we are putting it in the orbit. Second one is IT. Development in IT has been so much in last 30-40 years. We have indeed done a great job in last 50 years. From Green Revolution 65 to say 50 years have passed almost. And achievements have been really a laudable achievement. We cannot take pride in that. But also remember that next 50 years are going to be much, much tougher than what we saw. It was easy to increase production, productivity, area and all that. Relatively much easier. But now, the growth is going to be very slow. So we need to come out with a new technology, with new knowledge, and that is where we have to address ourselves, whether we are imparting that knowledge and that technology to our students. And if you think we are not, then we have to revamp. I am delighted to see so much of a change, but I think much more change is required. With these few words, me and my co-chair, we have a division of labor. I'll introduce the speakers and start the session. And Dr. Maheshwar has very kindly agreed to conclude the session. But before I call upon Dr. Mukhopadhyay, I would like Dr. Maheshwar to say a few words if you wish to.
Good afternoon, friends. Well, at the outset, the choice of the subject for deliberation is quite apt. the sense now the arena of past agriculture required to be focused in different context. That means the earlier scholarly advice need to be fine-tuned or maybe have to redefine as scholar to entrepreneur. Another step is scholar to skillpreneurs. Maybe that's where we have to make this 21st century and further the agriculture education to have a new paradigm shift. I'm sure that you all agree with me that, you know, the skill part, which is supposed to be the core of the agriculture, has started in 1850s, also emphasizes the practice. It's beyond preaching. So such being the case, as of today, the, you know, the estimated percentage of skills in the agri sector and with the Indian scenario is less than 5%. So such being the case, the skills are a core part of the, you know, this entrepreneurship, thanks to Government of India, which has come out with a lot of programs to promote, you know, skills, and through this, you know, agri startups and Skill India, etc. So such being the case, it is already now the industry is now showing a lot of, you know, emergence with respect to conduct of lot of, you know, hackathons, where the skill promotion is being taken up as a campaign. It is now going to be an institutional one. So I am sure that over a period of time, from now onwards, let this 21st century be in the agriculture education, focus on practice and practicals. I'm sure that the employability of the agriculture and horticulture and agrarian disciplines, henceforth, they have a better employability over 30%. Right now we have only around 30%. I'm sure that with this type of, you know, skill being empowered, with this skill being enthused, I'm sure that the employability, the quantum will be going to be enhanced over 30%. And I'm sure also this skill is the one area, it's not only the production, from the perspective of primary processing, value addition and beyond, it calls for the skill enhancement. Now to address malnutrition as per the SDP goals, and also to, you know, support the primary processing, now it's time for everyone, including the modification and upgradation of the curricula, syllabus and pedagogy, also required to be focused on these agriculture skills. I'm sure the speakers are going to give an enlightened status of how these skills are going to make a headway towards the, you know, making this agriculture as a most value-added sector, and let the agrarian sector be enthused now onwards with the skill. With those few expectations from the speakers, I call upon the speakers to make their presentation. Thank you.
The presentation is on Reskilling Digital India by Mr. Lohit Venubaka, Assistant Manager, E-Yantra. May I request Dr. Venubaka to come?
Okay, I think you need to change the slides. Okay, good evening everyone. My name is Lohit. So, I am basically an assistant project manager at E-Yantra project. This is a project part of IIT Bombay. And the PI for this project is Professor Kavi Arya. So, he has made these slides due to some personal reasons. He's not able to make it for this event. So, I'll be presenting this talk. So, E-Yantra is basically short for engineering and engineering and electronics with machinery. So, E-Yantra started as a project to train students in embedded systems and robotics. Right? So, we started this E-Yantra 5 years back. Since then, we are moving towards entrepreneurship as the main goal. So the entrepreneurship with respect to which domain is a very big question mark, and this particular presentation is going to be a bit different from what we have seen so far. So entrepreneurship is required. Why is entrepreneurship required? Because there are lack of jobs and we need to create job creators. Right? So with respect to entrepreneurship, we at Yantra are concentrating towards agriculture. How we are doing it, we will see in this talk. So this is to summarize why do we need entrepreneurship? Because of the economic growth and the cost because of importing, we need to create more and more products that are part of that will be built in India. So that's the Make in India concept, correct? So a study done by Washington Accord says for the 21st century, what is required? Knowledge or skill is a big question mark. So according to many of us, I think both are required, correct? So apart from a list of parameters that they have found out, five create a very immediate contribution towards. The first is design of solutions, investigation, that is research, modern tool usages, individual and teamwork, and communication. So many of the speakers previously have been talking about collaboration, right? Teamwork is very, very important and collaboration goes hand in hand with it. Okay? So in approach to how to educate the engineering students across the country, we have almost 1 million engineers graduating every year. Okay? And it was a challenge for us to train so many students out there, right, to build the skill. So to overcome this, we had to think about different alternatives. So the first alternative that we thought about was distance education program, but this was not helpful because we were looking at how to provide hands-on experience for different students. Okay, so with this concept, we came up with a lab in a box. Okay, how can we bring the whole hands-on experience to the student within a small entity, right? So this gave basis to the first robot that was part of Yantra. Before Yantra, this bot was built as part of an MTech project in the ERTS lab in CS department. This robot is a very robust robot and it is very rugged. And we see that this as a training tool has been used by many of the students to create projects and take part in competitions that we hold. So once this MTech project was done, we asked few of the MTech students at IIT Bombay to try this and build something, right? So the first MTech project with this robot was a fruit sorting robot. So this small video that you would like to see, and it's very inspiring that how they are actually using a simple bot to solve an agricultural problem. So please video, please. So these are MTech students. So what they have done is they have built a mechanism to detect fruits and sort them with their respective bins. So they are not directly fruits, this is a prototyping project. So they have taken different colored ball and they have done some image processing. Using this image processing, they are going to segregate it based on what kind of fruit it's going to be, right? So then we saw that it comes as a camera right there, or right at the top there, the black, that does the image processing and it moves the conveyor
container to the respective containers. Okay? So this is done completely by MTech students using just that robot. You see that? Initially it was a yellow ball, so it was going to the left container, and then it's a green ball, it moved to the next container. So this all is done through image processing. So why I'm stressing this is, there is a need of engineering and agriculture to come hand in hand. Right? This is only engineering, but it's not restricted only to engineering or agriculture. You need even biology, chemistry, right? Other departments also to come together in accomplishing Make in India truly. Okay? Once we saw success in this MTech students, we put forth a proposal to MHRD to give funds to take it to the colleges outside. So in 2009, as a pilot state, we conducted workshops for faculty, and we have trained nearly 30 to 40 faculties with this bot and conducted a kind of a competition. Okay? And this competition was very difficult to handhold because the number of registrations that came in to us was large in number. So we had to work out with a different model. Okay? So the way we could do it is create a competition that involves students. When we create a competition, students are more pulled in so that they can take part and create awareness amongst themselves. Okay? So our PI, Professor Kavi Arya, is very much involved and inspired in agriculture. So the first robotics competition held was an agricultural theme based. Okay? So this is the rough map of the complete registrations from the last year. So we have a lot of registrations, a lot of students taking part in these competitions. And most of the time the competitions, every year it happens, and we had the fifth year of competition in 2017 of March 22nd. So ever since, from 2009 onwards, we have different themes being conducted, and most of the themes are related to agriculture. Okay? So we'll just see one of the video where we have seen PE students conduct projects to fulfill themes. So there are four themes in this particular competition. The first theme is seeding robot. There's no volume. So this is the same robot that we give to students. We train them also. So what they're doing is they're trying to segregate, right? They're going to sow different seeds in already created holes. The next is weeding robot. So this basically does, it pulls out the weeds, accumulates it and disposes of it. All this is done by the students, they are all PE, first, second and third year. We have very active students, they think very creatively and give a mechanical solution to most of the problems. This is fertilizing. So you can see how the story grew. First, we sowed some seeds, then we checked for weeds and then we are fertilizing it. Once the fertilizing is done, we are going to harvest them, right, using the same pot.
Everything is done at the same point. The mechanical structure is designed by the students by themselves. So what this pod is doing is basically pulling out the ripened fruits. So in this context, the orange one is the ripened fruit, the green is the non-ripened fruit. So again, I would like to stress that this is purely done by PG students. All that we provide to them is resource as to how to use the robot. Correct? Back to the slides. Similarly, like I said, on March 22nd, we had the latest competition. This competition really put students to their test. What we taught to them was 3D designing. Okay? We'll see a small video which the attraction of all the themes was a water snake. So this theme is basically building a snake, a robot snake, which can be used in silos where seeds are stored or rice or wheat is stored. Normally in these silos, there are rodents, positive rodents being in these silos. So how can we create a robot that can go into small corner tweaking places and catch these rodents, correct? So to inspire that, we created this spotter bot, spotter snake robot, okay? So every year, we are challenging the students to think more innovatively through the themes that we organize. So again, in this year's competition, it was completely agricultural based. We had harvester bot, we had collector bot, we had transporter bot, we had a lot of agricultural based themes. So we see a very interesting video right now again with respect to the spotter snake. Again, a reminder that everything is done by students. This is a very interesting theme because they have done the 3D design. They have built the snake, they have done the 3D modeling, they have 3D printed it, and they have assembled it and they have written the code for it. So here, what the snake is doing is, we have created the arena in such a way that the red and the blue are rodents, types of rodents. So as soon as it goes close to the rodent, it lights up the LED to indicate that there is a rodent, right? So this theme was conducted and shockingly, 23 teams were successful in designing the snake. But due to the restriction, we had to call only 6 to the finals, the best 6. So this shows that the students are very, very interested in doing different things. Only thing is that we don't, as faculty or universities, we don't encourage or we don't find ways to encourage the students. So it sees a rodent there and it just lights up the red color. So this is the latest competition video. So like I said, we have started our competitions. We started with 4,000 plus registrations and the last year we had nearly 23,000 plus students registering. And all these students are given the same material to go through and conduct an online selection test. Based on their performance, we shortlist them to actually take part in the competition. So apart from this 43,000, we cut them short all the way to 4 per team and we don't take more than 5 teams, right? So we have maximum 35 students at the max for each team. Understand, right? So with this robotics competition, what we've done is we have touched nearly 508 colleges across India. So this shows how interested the students are. Like I said before, addressing and training these students is a challenge. So what we came up with is an initiative called Yantra Lab Setup Initiative. So what we do is, we are setting up Yantra Labs across India so that we can train the faculty in that college, and the faculty will in turn train the students to take part in these competitions. So with this, we can outreach to a lot more students compared to we doing it directly. Right? So with respect to the target given by MHRD, initially we started with a target of 500 colleges in 3 years. And with that 500 as a target, we are able to accumulate 223 colleges as ESL colleges or hubs for Yantra across the country. So right now, as of now, the current count is 280 labs and still growing. Our current target is 1000 colleges by 2020. And we have covered almost all the states. It clearly says that 24 states have been covered. And majority of the colleges are from Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. Now this must be interesting. During the course of this competition, we thought that farm setup should be done in all the engineering colleges. So we started this Yantra Farm Setup Initiative last year. So we came up with an IoT test bed, and we are concentrating on IoT as a solution to agricultural problems. Okay? This gave birth to Krishi Yantra, K-Yantra in short. So most of you may not know what IoT is. IoT is basically collection of data from different sensors. We accumulate them, we send it off to a remote cloud, and then you can do some processing in the cloud. So all of this infrastructure is already built in our lab. And we, as Yantra, are providing education to different colleges. We have deployed this model to all the engineering colleges. And I'm very happy to say that just in 1 year, we have 8 colleges actively taking part in this initiative. So this initiative mainly concentrates on converting all their solid waste in by composting, and then using their terrace as gardens. Okay, we'll see a set of photos from the different colleges that have already set up all this. So what we provide as part of this initiative is, we teach them how to create compost and create Amrit Mitti. And using the Amrit Mitti, they will create troughs for growing. Okay, and to actuate the irrigation system, we have wireless valves. And to take the sensor data, we have sensors. All of this know-hows will be given to faculty and students who become part of Yantra. So this is the complete setup that we have done in IIT Bombay campus. And this is also being copied in many of the colleges. Like I said, 8 colleges are already taking part in this activity. And this is the farm on CSE department test. So if you are coming to IIT Bombay, you can definitely visit the CSE terrace farm. And like I said, these are few snapshots of the farm that the engineering colleges have set up. Few have set up in their open space, few have set up on the terrace. Right, and they are making use of the wireless sensor valves that we have given and the sensor nodes to collect information. So sensor nodes in the sense that we are basically accumulating moisture, air temperature, air humidity. Right, so all of this will be pushed to the AWS cloud service that we have. So what are the different research that we are looking at is a broad spectrum. And none of this is restricted to engineering or technology. All of this can be used in any domain possible. Correct? So even this research areas can be used in agriculture also. Similarly, we had to invoke the interest in students. We started this ideas competition where we asked the students to exhibit their proposals and their project implementations in a common platform every year after the competition that we have every year. And this is a very interesting initiative called the IENTHA Symposium, where we ask all the teachers who have been trained to come and share their know-hows, what they have learned and what we can give them more through the IENTHA initiative. So the whole IENTHA initiative is basically empowering engineering students using project-based learning. So what is the impact for this? It raises self-confidence and technical skills in students. Okay? So this is the IENTHA team. It's a total of 30 members. And we are completely hand-holding the 280 colleges to take part in all the different initiatives that we have. Right? So I would like to conclude the talk by saying, I am rephrasing everything again. Problems that occur in one discipline may be solved by other disciplines for sure. So we should come together and be part as one to create more entrepreneurs and make an India happen. Thank you.
Thank you for a wonderful presentation. Now I would like to call upon Ms. Dr. V.G. Mukhopadhyay, who will speak on innovations for enhancing employability and entrepreneurship development in agriculture. Dr. Mukhopadhyay, please.
Excuse me, sir. With due respect and permission of the chair, I just would like to make a sincere announcement. Like, when you would visit tomorrow, we would show you some of our creations. That is all. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's really a wonderful opportunity, and first of all, I would like to thank the host, G.D. Rai Sunni University, and ICA, and my friend Dr. Chetty, who has spoken profusely about me, which I don't deserve. I also felt intimidated to be in a gathering where galaxies of vice chancellors are there, who themselves have laid the university system, which is a knowledge generation system. And I was just thinking that what I will be speaking to them, it will be some sort of a novice who is speaking to a very experienced person. But then I took the courage that telling something which they know it, I should bring some personal narratives so that it becomes much more lively to them, like what I tried to solve the problem within the existing system of ICR research system, teaching, research and education. As an employee of NABARD, when I headed different ROs, regional offices, particularly very disadvantaged regions of the country, Jammu and Kashmir and Arunachal Pradesh. And this is number one. And number two is that normally I don't like to present on that, PowerPoint, because I'm not a very fan follower of PowerPoint, because I know power corrupts and PowerPoints absolutely. After some point of time, you never know that which side who has shown it. So I wanted to connect with the people, but as a matter of statutory consideration, I thought that I should put it. Then I told one of my colleagues, these are the ideas, you just put it on some slides and give it, because I don't know that how much it will add to your knowledge. But just I have kept it for your, perusal. But I will just try to bring my understanding on the subject. I have done my doctorate in agricultural extension, but incidentally I joined a number. Chetty has gone to the university system. Whenever I have gone to the foreign universities, I was a Asia Pacific Leadership Program in East West Center in the University of Hawaii. So they were asking, are you a banker? Because in your presentations and others, you don't seem to be a banker. Debit, credit, and all those very conservative kind of an outlook. And the second thing is that there was, I mean, when the course coordinator was conducting program, so there was one management guru, I should say, lady who came, and everybody was asked that, do you know about this person? We have the guys from Harvard and other, I mean, universities. So they could not tell. Then they asked me, I mean, my course coordinator knew it, whether Venu will answer something or that. Then when he asked me, Dr. Nick Barton, Venu, do you know this lady who is coming about, I mean, about her personal profile and all that? I said, I know very well. Then I told about her, and then she said that, he said that, how do you know it? I said, I know not only her works, but I have met her also in the US university. Then he said, you be there, I mean, with her when she comes to the campus, so that you can tell. Then I had an interview with her. She was Margaret Wheatley, and she has written a wonderful book on leadership and the new science, which was just one of the best books in the Financial Times. And I had also an interview with her. She, when she wrote the book, in fact, the Oval House, I mean, under Bill Clinton, asked his colleagues that you must read these books, what she has told about the leadership. Leadership, there are hundreds of theories, but basic thing is that when you come as a leader, like vice chancellor of the university, then you know most of the theories don't work, because when you see the practical situation, you find that keep aside the theories, and the practice is entirely different. I also believe on that, yeah, because many of the theories which they preached from the Harvard or MIT case studies, it doesn't appeal to me, even though I studied abroad. I have worked in Bill Gates Foundation in education, and I found that many of the things which our people do it in our Indian context in a very remotest area, those are far more relevant and those are far more contextual. I met one gentleman when I was an education intern in Bill Gates Foundation. Sorry, I'm a little digressing from that, but I'm just telling the context. So she was he was a mathematics teacher. Mostly the American teachers in the math school, they're very bad, and they just end up, many of the students, when I was interviewing the teachers in the American schools, both because it was funded by Bill Gates, he was trying to break the big schools into small project learning, e-learning, magnet schools, chartered school, voucher schools, all kinds of things. So I was asking that, what is the status of mathematics teaching there? They said it is horrible, students don't go there. Then I met one teacher, Indian teacher, and incidentally he is from Andhra Pradesh, Telugu teacher, maths. You know that Andhra Pradesh, still the tradition of maths and statics the best in the country. Because I was in Andhra Pradesh, I know, I have met, and we go in any US universities, including Microsoft, 30-40% are from Andhra. Why? Because maths and stats are very strong in their itself. I mean, education in the, my son was studying in a very obscure school, but the kind of teaching they used to have it in Andhra Pradesh, it was far better than the best of the so-called, you know, American schools and other schools. So we should not have any hangover that whatever it is, foreign or alien or US or Harvard, these are very good and our people are producing junk. That's not true at all. I find that we need to come out from this paradigm. And that is where I would like to suggest that let us innovate from our own system. Necessity is the mother of invention. And from that necessity, we can come out of this innovation. How we can structure our content of learning so that we don't become, irrelevant. It was correct when land-grant universities were set up, then we came up with a particular year that was the feeding the population. As Dr. Rajan Walker has correctly said, that the first, agriculture one was feeding the people. And then the agriculture second, feeding the people for our countries, for the entire world. But now the agriculture three is feeding the future. USA has a program feeding the future. So how the future people get the food, access to food and other, for that our agriculture system, university system, how the education, teaching, learning and the content should be changed. That needs to be, I think, looked into properly. And that is where I feel that we cannot change the behavior by calling the sadhus or saints or other. What we know from the knowledge of economics, you have to change the incentive. Incentive changes the behavior of the people. So how can I incentivize my system, agriculture education system, so that the people, students, they become a sort of a, innovator, they become sort of creative, they become impatient, I should say, for doing something new, meaningful. Like my predecessor, when he was sewing the slides of the you know, robotics and all. Our people, when they go abroad, they are just innovating. Why they can't do it? So why can't we create a sort of an ecosystem in our, I mean, university, where the people, the students, they can become very innovative. But let me tell you, all will not become innovative. Somebody will be going for the civil service, somebody will be going for the banks, somebody will be going for the routine job. But you need to produce some unreasonable man. I quote George Bernard Shaw, the reasonable man adapts himself to the world, the unreasonable one persists in trying to adapt the world to himself. Therefore, all progress depends on the unreasonable man. So my appeal to the vice chancellors of the university, how can you produce the unreasonable man in your campus, in your course curriculum? How you can create, I mean, build up that, you know, spark so that they become very creative. And, you know, in a classroom situation, you have 150 students. You cannot say that you should be like this, how can you customize a particular thing with a particular thing. I think that remains a challenge. And there we have to search out something. But I found that it is also not that difficult. I had a professor, and many of you must be knowing also. Yeah, he was an HAU professor, and then he was in IR, in Extension Department, Dr. YPC. He was one of the brilliant professors I have seen in my life in a foreign university, Indian university, that such a professor is there. He used to tell, when he used to, I mean, post-class session, he used to take without any PowerPoint, without any, at that time, PowerPoint was also not there, laptop, palm top and all. And 3 hours spellbound, he used to keep us and engaged with our discussions and all. And then afterwards, when the lecture, you know, exam sessions come, he used to give us clear-cut instruction, no routine replies. You give a creative answer to my questions which I am asking. Those who will be writing the creative answers, they will be given 95%, 96%. But those who will be given routine answers, I am not going to hear. Now you see, I have met many professors in your life, but I have never come such a, which I really enjoy, and all people also enjoy. Then we used to, stretch our bends that how we can do it, how we can think up in a different way, divergent thinking, not the convergent thinking. And we used to come up with a very brilliant type of new ideas. And let me tell you, when I did an OD, organization development in a bank, in a very precarious situation in Bihar, I did it, in a very different way, and my inspirations was not from any foreign books, but Professor YPC, he told me, as not just me alone, that how you can think in a very different way, very creative way to come up with a solution. And I did it in the Organizational Change Program, which was very much appreciated by the President of American Psychological Association, Martin Seligman. Martin Seligman has said, he has written a book also, 30 years of research, he did it in the University of Pennsylvania, and there he came up with that learned optimism. Because most of the time, many a time, we feel helplessness. Like, we have a problem. I mean, all of you have told us, environmental problem. Venkata Saru is the very renowned expert in the country and abroad also. There are many challenges we face. Soil problem, water problem, forestry problem, then global warming problems. All these problems are there. But how problems can be converted into a solution, that solution is, more important, and how we can do it. And that is, in an organizational change context, I do it. So, and he appreciated. He said that President Seligman, American Psychological Association, he told it about that how the people become helplessness, develop the helplessness. That it is because in his programming of mind, he develops a sort of negative thinking or pessimistic thinking. And that pessimism leads to sort of an inaction, that leads to some sort of a helplessness that I can't do it. So if you can change or program that, like in the software language, that software of mind, in a situation where pessimism can be turned into an optimism, then it will be different, game altogether. So what I did, I took that individual perspective into an organizational perspective. You have seen many of the helpless organizations, they will find, aray, yahan par kuch nahi hoga. Aap bhi, jab ICR system hai, aap jisi bolenge, bhai, aisa karne, sir, hum log try kiya hai, wo hota nahi hai. Yahan par dusra kiya. When I went to, organizational change management program in Bihar, Wampar Bihar, Gopalganj, where, it's a very difficult terrain. They said, sir, yahan par bahut kuch try hua, kuch bhi nahi ho sakta. But then I tried, to convince, nothing was appealing to them. Then I just tried to find out, is there any good branch manager who is doing something very good work? Then the chairman of the bank said, yes, there is one. And then I tried to bring his profile and present it to the bank's manager. Do you know, I mean, yeah, how he is doing it? He said that he is one amongst us. I said that how he is doing. He is not from abroad. He is not from Salukanabar Gramin Bank. He is not from Prathama Gramin Bank. How he is doing it? So that led to a sort of a change. And then they gave a memorandum of understanding with me. If this branch manager who comes at 9:30, goes at 7:30 or 8 o'clock, works in the, you know, candlelight, not earlier, because if you go on that region, there is a, you know, PM mafia, diesel mafia. So all the time, but generator, electricity, that is not available. And still the people were doing it. They were committed. And in a very difficult year in a Bihar, these people are doing it. So mind that the people are there, those who are committed, those who are here, but they may not be very good, large in number, but they can be inspiring to inspire others. So I said that if this branch manager can do it, then why you cannot do it? Then they gave a memorandum of understanding to me, sir, we will also show you that here. You come after 3 months and see the results. And I went on and then reviewed the program from time to time. And within 3 years, they made a very good turnaround. And President, Principal of Administrative Staff College of India, Dr. Dharani Sinha, he reviewed the program, evaluated the program. He was one of the best OD, organizational behavior scientists in our country. He was professor in IIM Calcutta. He taught abroad. Recently, he retired a few years back. And he did this, evaluation for OD for entire country. And he said that this was the best year. Then called who has done it. Then I just made a presentation and he was absolutely thrilled. And he said that your work really deserves a prize abroad. You should try it. First year I didn't get it. Second year I gave all evidences from myself, from the bank, from the third party evaluation. And I got the award. And Professor Golembowski was a professor in political science in the University of Georgia. He said that Benu, you could take your work further because it has got a spark. What I wanted to be, exaggerate by what I have been telling, I am doing. Basic thing is that here itself, we have to find out the solution for our problems. Nobody else will do. No gods and goddesses will do. And we have the people. And I believe that whatever the system, human system, resource system in our country, it is there. It is absolutely brilliant. There is no doubt. If somebody says that he has got capacity in here, ability is required to recognize the ability. If I don't have the ability, then I say, kisi ko kaam nahi hai, uska kuch kaam hai, aata nahi hai, he is useless, he is waste, But if I have the ability, then I can understand that he has the, or she has the ability. So that is the first fundamental here, which needs to have a paradigm shift in our human resource management, also attitudinal change. And third thing, which I found it, from my work in that, in Arunachal, Krishi Vigyan Kendra was there. Earlier there was a reference on the Krishi Vigyan Kendra. And I brought it to the notice of our NABARD board also. Secretary Agriculture was there, Secretary Finance was there, Secretary Rural Development was there. And I said that those people who said that in ICS system nobody can do it, here is one KVK, I can guarantee you, you just go and see how it bands a bunch of young people. When I landed up in Itanagar, it's a very small place. I talked to them, which are the resources are there, then I met that Krishi Vigyan Kendra, very young, talented fellow. They were sitting idle because they want to do something but they don't have the money. So I said that you have the talent, I have the money. Let us try to do something. And we had the WADI program for the tribes, for the DDA projects in that area, but nothing has happened. They said that there is no NGO. Then I said that ICR itself is an NGO because it is registered under the society and it has floated a KVK. So I will support it and we did it. And you will be surprised to know that it is running very well. And I asked many successors that how it is here. Is there any fraud? Is there any misgovernance? Is there any malpractice? Nothing of that sort happened. And within the existing system, if we can do it, then why? What I did is just only bringing the NGO in that. I just brought the KVK as a service provider. For the technical service provider. Uska niche ke, I kept the NGO. Then the farmers club, then the farmers, and it worked wonderfully well. So here is a small tweaking of organizational innovations I did, nothing else. And I found with that itself, it could make a remarkable change in many of our schemes, like NABARD scheme or the tribal development program, and we did it. I had a lot of arguments with my office, that head office, that there is a circular and all that. I said, Golimara circular. So I see that this is the context, and this is the way I have to go ahead, and we have to help and support the people. And it worked wonderfully well. So the long and short of this issue which I am trying to bring in this forum is that innovation has to be done based on the necessity of the people. If you feel the pain, because if there is a pain, if you feel, you try to address that pain from your side. and then you will come out that what could be the alternative. Then you come out with that this idea how it can be a business solution. Then you come out how the business solutions can be executed at the farmers' level or the people's level. Honorable Prime Minister has given a call for this doubling of farmers' income. The first thing I did is, yes, it can be done. Because daily a lot of think tanks, professor, they will say, no, 3% growth rate, 2% here, push near. Arey Baba, that is a macro level. I am taking 10 farmers, I will show that how 10 farmers' income can be doubled. But micro level, bottom up. Why you have to think up from the macro level and all that? And I told many of the think tank people, I know everybody in the Delhi capital, because I studied there, I was a student union leader. When Arun Jaitley sir was there in the university, Delhi University, I was in the IRI, and I set up a study circle, and I am very happy that Rathore sir has done so much, and his colleagues also, for the scholarship enhancement. That time from 350 to 700, I had to lot of, I struggle. I lobbied with the, that time H.N. Bhoguna was there in the opposition, then Charan Singh sir was there, and most of the leaders I took it, and then they raised the issue in the parliament. We also made some alabulla, and then director and all, ultimately they acceded to. But now the situation is much more changed, because the government is very proactive to help it. The Prime Minister is very, proactive that the things should happen. And now we should grab this opportunity. And Patil sir is there, who is very much a farmer-friendly vice-chancellor. When I saw him first thing, our chairman Nabard was telling that this is one vice-chancellor I see, that when the farmers are coming to seek his advice at 10 o'clock in the night. So that is the type of concern which he has got. So many of you are also having it. The basic thing is that if I feel the pains of the people, do I have some sort of a engagement with that pain so that I can pay and translate that pain into an opportunity to relieve that pain with some innovative products, services, processes, technology, and whatever it is, and create a good business model. I think it is possible, and many of the people who have been doing work in the university system, I'm very much encouraged that it is very much possible within this realm, within this given role space, we can do it. Only thing that we must engage in, collaborate, co-create, and have a dialogue, not just working as a silo with one another, individual, lab to lab, why are you telling it? Because we don't have any communication. So let us have engage in the communication. And with the concept of David Baum's dialogue, I should suspend my assumptions about you. And when I communicate with you, then I am not going with a stereotype and with a lot of baggages. Then I can really establish authentic communication, and we can really such as solutions for the problems which you are confronted with. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mukhopadhyay, for such an inspiring presentation. Friends, now there is a third presentation. Title is not there, but is Dr. Sharad Nimbalkar there?
Yes.
Dr. Sharad Nimbalkar, former Vice Chancellor of PDKB Akola, will speak on the subject of his choice, topic of his choice.
Skill and knowledge.
Very good evening to all. Now you are not in a mood to listen. Give me 5 to 10 minutes to deliver what I am to speak about. I am not going to talk on the mostly the bookish or with the reference. What I would be speaking about is my own experience and what I feel particularly about the education, the formal education, the education in India has been explained very nicely by the TD, Honorable TD, and other aspects of the state of agriculture of the country has also been given and enumerated, illustrated nicely. But what I am to say, and when many of the things which are to be reformed have been also been given, and there I like it one, that is a scientific societal responsibility, is to be created in our country from the educational point of view. Because it is missing, totally missing. Not only that scientific societal commitment, but societal commitment to the agriculture and the plight and agony of the agriculture, and therefore all the problems and the issues which have come up in the country, and that has terminated into such a by implementation that near about 4 lakhs of the people, the agricultural farmers, are to commit the